Well, good evening, and welcome to the fourth event in this academic year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, director of the Hall Center, which organizes the lectures. Thank you for coming out this evening. March is a difficult month for the humanities. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you Natasha Trethewey, renowned poet, university teacher, and former United States Poet Laureate, the first African-American to be so honored since Rita Dove in 1993, a poet who also graced the Humanities Lecture Series in 2004. Our guest speaker will take questions after her talk if you would make your way to one of the two microphones. And afterwards in the Jayhawk Room, which is opposite this auditorium, there's a reception where Professor Trethewey will sign copies of her book. So please do join us there. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock in the Hall Center, Professor Trethewey will take part in an extended conversation about her poetry. These morning events are interactive and enjoyable occasions, and I encourage you to attend. A number of students from Lawrence High will be there asking penetrating questions. To introduce our guest speaker, I asked Mary Emma Graham, University Distinguished Professor of English. Mary Emma has degrees from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, Northwestern University, and Cornell. She was a faculty member at the University of Mississippi and Northeastern University before coming to KU in 1999 by way of the Langston Hughes Visiting Professorship. Her resume is long and distinguished, the most noticeable feature of which, however, is the sheer engagement of her scholarship. She has a passion for recovering and promoting the history of literacy and literature through the project on the history of black writing. She has a commitment to international collaborative work, notably the Cambridge History of African American Literature, published in 2011, a book 10 years in the making, and more recently, the edition of essays with University of Paris 8, entitled Toni Morrison, Beyond the Ordinary Visible. She has also done more than anyone at KU to gain external grant support in the humanities, especially from the National Endowment for the Humanities, to advance public engagement with poetry and with the works of Toni Morrison, Richard Wright, and Margaret Walker. There are few better qualified to introduce tonight's guest speaker. So please welcome my good colleague, Professor Mary Emma Graham.
Thank you, Victor. Good evening, everyone, and happy Women's History Month. We will forget about March Madness temporarily. Now and again, there comes along a writer who speaks the truth to us as a nation, as a people, as a community of readers and writers, the kind of truth that we are often resistant to hearing. Such a writer is Natasha Trethewey, who speaks, in the words of her several critics, with beauty and grace, restraint and elegance, in poetry that is a rhythmic blend of stillness and motion. And yet, as she said to us in our NEH webinar, Don't Deny My Voice, she hopes that people recognize the fierceness in her voice, just as they understand the intentionality of her words. We listen not only because she has been our National Poet Laureate, or as her official title states, the consultant in poetry to the Library of Congress, serving not one but two terms, 2012 to 2014, but also because her word pictures quite literally cross multiple boundaries and engage distinct and often oppositional discourses to create what she calls a shared history that connects people across time and space to each other. As most have agreed, the distinctive feature of Trethewey's poetry is its ability to bring together public and private history, national and familial narratives, into a seamless whole. Those tensions are ever present for her. They define her very being and her project as an artist. As the title Native Guard suggests, her ballad sequence on the first Union Army regiment of black soldiers in the Civil War, Trethewey sees herself as a native guardian to those historical memories that we must, in her own words, recover and inscribe as much as we can. Hence her commitment to re-examine the erasures of history, to narrate lived experience and the unwritten record, to transform and preserve the South as one of its native daughters. If writing for her is a duty, an obligation, her destiny and themes chosen for her, then it is also a kind of poetic justice. What could be more ironic than being named the Poet Laureate of the very state that forced her parents into exile, that determined her birth illegitimate, Trethewey reminds us, because the laws of miscegenation in the state of Mississippi. An interracial couple had to go outside the South to become legally husband and wife. And while Trethewey has left the South on occasion, she is deeply indebted to the region and continues to make her home in and write about the South. Between 2000 and 2012, she has published 7 highly acclaimed books, including 1 edited collection, and is currently at work on a memoir I'm really excited to look for since I teach autobiography. She is our foremost scholar poet, conducting extensive research that includes labor history, photography, iconography, the global South, place, and environment. And for her 2nd volume in particular, The History of Prostitution. Her 4 volumes of poetry present uncommon subjects, like the black and white working women who frequent the pages of domestic work, or a young woman living between 1910 and 1912 in the Storyville section of New Orleans in Bellocq's Ophelia. Her interest in these women's lives match her 2007 Pulitzer Prize winning 3rd volume, Native Guard, that appeared in 2 separate editions, and her most recent volume, Thrall, both books that all admittedly bear a direct connection to the loss and memory of her mother. For the 5th anniversary of Katrina, she elected to memorialize the people and the place in a mixed genre text, Beyond Katrina, a meditation on the Mississippi Gulf Coast, paying homage to her birthplace and showing her keen interest in environmental and social issues. I first met Natasha at the Natchez Literary and Cinema Celebration, where she received the Richard Wright Excellence Award. This weekend, I was back there for my annual pilgrimage, and I reread Thrall during my forced 2-day stay in a small southern airport, wholly unprepared for bad weather. The reading made me realize again how fortunate we are to have Natasha Trethewey at this time in our young and old lives. A highly gifted poet and visionary, she is our best example of a modern-day literary archaeologist, digging beneath the surface of the human experience, exploding and exploring the intimacies of the past that have created our present. Through her excavations, she brings us back the richness of people's lives in poems that capture their stories, voices, their faces, people who, like her own mother, lie buried in unmarked graves. Trethewey has often remarked, "I embody the story of America in my person, its integration of cultures." And yet that story remains in the shadows of American history. Trethewey is fiercely determined to shed a new and different light on those shadows. In Thrall, a most ambitious work that took her 6 years to complete, she goes more deeply into the most difficult subjects of our time: race, blood, and difference, those issues that divide us and bind us together. I think of poetry as social practice, not just an aesthetic one, Trethewey says. With this, I couldn't agree more. Will you please give a warm Jayhawk welcome to Natasha Trethewey?
Thank you. Mary Emma really makes all that sound great, and I feel for a moment that I might just for a moment, be smarter because of all the things you said. Thank you. And thank you all for coming tonight. Collections of poems usually begin, for me, with a question rooted in history that I am trying to investigate, if not answer. My most recent collection, Thrall, considers the history of ideas, the production of knowledge about race across time and space, particularly the deeply ingrained and often unexamined notions of racial difference, ideas that manifest as supremacy and inferiority, which were codified during the Enlightenment, the Age of Reason, and that stay with us even now. I consider the representation of these ideas in a variety of texts and in art, in my own family, and, for example, in the Mexican Costa paintings, the Costa paintings of colonial Mexico that represented across the 18th century the mixed-blood unions that were taking place in the colony. I was really interested in these paintings because they were always done in series of 16. They began with the white Spaniard father and showed all of the different interracial unions and the mixed-blood children that they would have created. I was interested in them also because the taxonomies, the various terms created to name the mixed blood people, were painted right on the paintings as well. So you had that interaction between image and between word. Also, the idea that across a few generations of intermarriage, indigenous blood could be purified to whiteness, but that the taint of African blood was irreversible. So you had names like Mulatto Returning Backwards, Hold Yourself in Midair, and I Don't Understand You. If you were born a mixed blood, a Costa, your name was recorded at birth in the Book of Costas. This is from a series by Juan Rodriguez Juarez, circa 1715. Taxonomy. One, de Español y de India produce mestizo. The canvas is a leaden sky behind them, heavy with words, gold letters inscribing an equation of blood. This plus this equals this, as if a contract with nature or a museum label, ethnographic, precise. See how the father's hand beneath its crown of lace curls around his daughter's head. She's nearly fair as he is. Calidad. See it in the brooch at her collar, the lace framing her face. An infant, she is born over the servant's left shoulder, bound to him by a sling, the plain blue cloth knotted at his throat. If the father, his hand on her skull, divines, as the physiognomist does, the mysteries of her character, discursive, legible on her light flesh, in the soft curl of her hair, we cannot know it. So gentle the eye he turns toward her. The mother, glancing sideways toward him, the scarf on her head, white as his face, his powdered wig, gestures with one hand a shape like the letter C. C, she seems to say, what we have made. The servant, still a child, cranes his neck, turns his face up toward all of them. He is dark as history, origin of the word native, the weight of blood, a pale mistress on his back, heavier every year. 2. De Español y Negra produce mulatto. Still, the centuries have not dulled the sullenness of the child's expression. If there is light inside him, it does not shine through the paint that holds his face in profile, his domed forehead, eyes nearly closed beneath a heavy brow. Though inside, the boy's father stands in his cloak and hat. It's as if he's just come in, or that he's leaving. We see him transient, rolling a cigarette, myopic, his eyelids drawn against the child passing before him. At the stove, the boy's mother contorts, watchful, her neck twisting on its spine, red beads yoked at her throat like a necklace of blood, her face so black she nearly disappears into the canvas, the dark wall upon which we see the words that name them. What should we make of any of this? Remove the words above their heads, put something else in place of the child, a table, perhaps, upon which the man might set his hat, or a dog upon which to bestow the blessing of his touch. And the story changes. The boy is a palimpsest of paint, layers of color, history rendering him that precise shade of in-between. Before this, he was nothing, blank canvas, before image or word, before a last brushstroke fixed him in his place. 3. De Español y Mestiza produce Castiza. How not to see in this gesture the mind of the colony? In the mother's arms, the child hinged at her womb, dark cradle of mixed blood, call it Mexico, turns toward the father, reaching to him as if back to Spain, to the promise of blood alchemy, 3 easy steps to purity. From a Spaniard and an Indian, a mestizo. From a mestizo and a Spaniard, a castizo. From a castizo and a Spaniard, a Spaniard. We see her here, one generation away, nearly slipping her mother's careful grip. 4. The Book of Castas. Call it the catalog of mixed bloods, or the Book of Not, not Spaniard, not white, but mulatto returning backwards, or hold yourself in midair, and the Morisca, the Lobo, the Chino, Sambo, Albino, and the No Te Entiendo, the I Don't Understand You. Guidebook to the colony, record of each crossed birth, it is the typology of taint, of stain, blemish, sullying spot, that which can be purified, that which cannot, Canaan's black fate. How like a dirty joke, it seems. What do you call that space between the dark geographies of sex? Call it the taint, as in it taint one and it taint the other, illicit and yet naming still what is between. Between her parents, the child, mulatto returning backwards, cannot slip their hold. The triptych their bodies make, in paint, in blood, her name, written down in the book of castas, all her kind in thrall to a word. So we are approaching the 50th anniversary of the Supreme Court decision, Loving versus the State of Virginia, which is, of course, the decision that ruled that anti-miscegenation laws in state constitutions were unconstitutional. I love the fact that it took a couple named Loving to get that decision. Except it's not ancient history as we might seem to think it is. Only in the late 90s in the state of Alabama did they vote to remove the anti-miscegenation laws from the books. And though they agreed, and about 42% of the voting population, I think, voted that they should remove them. The rest of the people wanted to keep those laws so that at least it could be said symbolically that parents like mine couldn't be married legally and people like me born legally in the state. Just a few years ago, a judge in New Orleans tried to prevent an interracial couple from getting a marriage license. Funny how we're seeing that same language used even now for people who just want to love and marry each other. Miscegenation. In 1965, my parents broke two laws of Mississippi. They went to Ohio to marry, returned to Mississippi. They crossed the river into Cincinnati, a city whose name begins with a sound like sin, the sound of wrong, miss in Mississippi. A year later, they moved to Canada, followed a route the same as slaves, the train slicing the white glaze of winter, leaving Mississippi. Faulkner's Joe Christmas was born in winter, like Jesus, given his name for the day he was left at the orphanage, his race unknown in Mississippi. My father was reading War and Peace when he gave me my name. I was born near Easter, 1966, in Mississippi. When I turned 33, my father said, "It's your Jesus year. You're the same age he was when he died." It was spring, the hills green in Mississippi. I know more than Joe Christmas did. Natasha is a Russian name, though I'm not. It means Christmas child, even in Mississippi. In many ways, this is Thrall, the book I'm going back to. I have to tell you that when I was finishing up my previous collection, Native Guard, from which the poem I just read comes, I do a thing that I always do, which is to look up words in the dictionary, words that, of course, I know, but need to be reminded of the secondary and tertiary and on definitions for the possibilities of deepening the figurative levels of a poem. When I looked up the word native, I was surprised to see the primary definition that comes up. Its primary usage was not what I had thought, not someone who's a native of Kansas or a plant native to the Gulf Coast region, but instead, native was someone born into the condition of servitude, a thrall. And so we have with the word already the idea of empire, of colonization. When we go there to colonize those people, they are the natives, and they are enthralled to us. I felt also the thrall of language, the way it seeks to name us and thus to shape our experience of the world. And in this next poem, in this book, I'm having a very intimate, private conversation in many ways with my father, who is also a poet, in a very public form, but in the only language that I think he would really listen to. The book begins with a couple of epigraphs, the first from Robert Penn Warren and the second from T.S. Eliot, that are meant to be in conversation. What is love? One name for it is knowledge. After such knowledge, what forgiveness? So my father, as I mentioned, is also a poet. And this poem uses a line from a poem of his. It's after a chalk drawing by J.H. Hasselhorst, 1864. Knowledge. Whoever she was, she comes to us like this. Lips parted, long hair spilling from the table like water from a pitcher, nipples drawn out for inspection. Perhaps to foreshadow the object she'll become, a skeleton on a pedestal, a row of skulls on a shelf. To make a study of the ideal female body, four men gather around her. She is young and beautiful and drowned, a Venus de Medici risen from the sea, sleeping. As if we could mistake this work for sacrilege, the artist entombs her body in a pyramid of light, a temple of science over which the anatomist presides. In the service of beauty, to know it, he lifts a flap of skin beneath her breast as one might draw back a sheet. We will not see his step-by-step parsing, a translation, Mary or Catherine or Elizabeth, to corpus, areola, vulva. In his hands, instruments of the empirical, scalpel, pincers, cold as the room must be cold, all the men in coats, trimmed in velvet or fur, soft as the down of her pubis. Now one man is smoking. Another tilts his head to get a better look. Yet another, at the head of the table, peers down as if enthralled, his fist on a stack of books. In the drawing, this is only the first cut, a delicate wounding, and yet how easily the anatomist's blade opens a place in me, like a curtain drawn upon a room in which each learned man is my father. And I hear again his words. I study my crossbreed child. Misnomer and taxonomy, the language of zoology. Here he is all of them, the preoccupied man, an artist, collector of experience, the skeptic angling his head, his thoughts tilting toward what I cannot know, the marshaller of knowledge, knuckling down a stack of books, even the dissector, his scalpel in hand like a pen poised above me, aimed straight for my heart. My father and I used to give readings together. We'd often stand at the podium and go back and forth because we had poems that spoke to each other, a kind of call and response that illuminated parts of our shared experience. And my father encouraged me to be a poet, and he really anticipated the day that I would become a poet, but he also dreaded it because he knew that I would set the story straight. It took me 40 years of hearing that poem and then standing beside him as he read it, a lovely poem called Her Swing, before I knew what it was that didn't feel quite right to me. It was always that moment when I'm called a crossbreed, which is, of course, not actually possible for a human being to be, that I felt like the Venus Hottentot on display. That's one of the places that the considerations of ideas across time and space about race comes from in this book. And it comes out of not only the language of the Enlightenment. I mean, let your mind wrap around that for a moment. With all the things that the Enlightenment brought us, it also brought us these codified ideas about racial difference, about superiority and inferiority. But also that even in loving families, we might still harbor those ideas of difference. Elegy for my father. I think by now the river must be thick with salmon. Late August, I imagine it as it was that morning. drizzle needling the surface, mist at the banks like a net settling around us, everything damp and shining. That morning, awkward and heavy in our hip waders, we stalked into the current and found our places, you upstream a few yards and out far deeper. You must remember how the river seeped in over your boots and you grew heavier with that defeat. All day I kept turning to watch you, how first you mimed our guide's casting, then cast your invisible line, slicing the sky between us. And later, rod in hand, how you tried again and again to find that perfect arc, flight of an insect skimming the river's surface. Perhaps you recall I cast my line and reeled in two small trout we could not keep. Because I had to release them, I confess I thought about the past, working the hooks loose, the fish writhing in my hands, each one slipping away before I could let go. I can tell you now that I tried to take it all in, record it for an elegy I'd write one day when the time came. Your daughter, I was that ruthless. What does it matter if I tell you I learned to be? You kept casting your line, and when it did not come back empty, it was tangled with mine. Some nights, dreaming, I step again into the small boat that carried us out and watch the bank receding, my back to where I know we are headed. Perhaps many of you know some of those phrases that were devised to suggest the presence of black blood. You may even know more than I do, but growing up in the South, you learn a lot of those. Touched by the tar brush, for example, one you might know. This next poem is about a kind of a phrase like that, but one from colonial Mexico. Mano Prieta. The green drapery is like a sheet of water behind us, a cascade in the backdrop of the photograph, a rushing current that would scatter us, carry us each away. This is 1969, and I am 3, still light enough to be nearly the color of my father. His armchair is a throne, and I am leaning into him, propped against his knees, his hand draped across my shoulder. On the chair's arm, my mother looms above me, perched at the edge as though she would fall off. The camera records her single gesture. Perhaps to still me, she presses my arm with a forefinger, makes visible a hypothesis of blood, its empire of words, the imprint on my body of her lovely, dark hand. I'm going to read an elegy for my mother now that relies a little bit on the myth of Orpheus and Eurydice, particularly that moment when Orpheus is trying to lead Eurydice out of the underworld and can't resist turning to look back and realizing at that moment that he's banished Eurydice back to the underworld. It's kind of like one of the dreams I've had about my mother. They're the kinds of dreams in which I know she's dead, and the dream feels like a lovely visitation. But it's the other kind of dream in which I don't know that she's gone or that anything has happened, from which I wake having to recognize that over again, turning over, opening my eyes, feeling what must have been Orpheus's fresh grief. Myth. I was asleep while you were dying. It's as if you slipped through some rift, a hollow I make between my slumber and my waking. The Erebus I keep you in, still trying not to let go. You'll be dead again tomorrow, but in dreams you live, so I try taking you back into morning. Sleep heavy, turning, my eyes open, I find you do not follow. Again and again, this constant forsaking. Again and again, this constant forsaking. My eyes open, I find you do not follow, you back into morning, sleep heavy, turning. But in dreams you live, so I try taking, not to let go. You'll be dead again tomorrow, the Erebus I keep you in, still trying. I make between my slumber and my waking. It's as if you slipped through some rift, a hollow. I was asleep while you were dying. This poem is after a photograph from the series The Americans by Robert Frank. Help, 1968. When I see Frank's photograph of a white infant in the dark arms of a woman who must be the maid, I think of my mother and the year we spent alone, my father at sea. The woman stands in profile, back against a wall, holding her charge, their faces side by side, the look on the child's face strangely prescient, a tiny furrow in the space between her brows. Neither of them looks toward the camera, nor do they look at each other. That year, when my mother took me for walks, she was mistaken again and again for my maid. Years later, she told me she'd say I was her daughter, and each time strangers would stare in disbelief, then empty the change from their pockets. Now I think of the betrayals of flesh, how she must have tried to make of her face an inscrutable mask and hold it there, as they made their small offerings, pressing coins into my hands. How like the woman in the photograph she must have seemed, carrying me each day white in her arms, as if she were a prop, a black backdrop, the dark foil in this American story. When I started to try to make sense of what has been given to us, what ideas have been passed down about difference across time and space, I had started, of course, in the 18th century, but I wanted to go back farther to see where else I might find those representations. And I came across several paintings as well as texts of the Miracle of the Black Leg. The Miracle of the Black Leg is about the patron saints of medicine, the brothers Cosmas and Damien, who in the miracle were told to fix the leg of a white sacristan. They had to remove his diseased leg and to replace it with a black leg. They were told at first a couple of different places to get the black leg. So sometimes you see them with a hacksaw in a graveyard taking the leg. Later on, you actually see them removing it from a live donor. These The narrative representations of the miracle of the black leg go back to about the 12th century, but the pictorial versions start appearing in about the 14th century and go through the 17th century or so. Miracle of the black leg. Always the dark body hewn asunder. Always one man is healed, his sick limb replaced, placed in the other man's grave, the white leg buried beside the corpse or attached as if it were always there. If not for the dark appendage, you might miss the story beneath this story. What remains each time the myth changes? How, in one version, the doctors harvest the leg from a man 4 days dead in his tomb at the church of a martyr. Or, in another, desecrate a body fresh in the graveyard at St. Peter in chains. There was buried just today an Ethiopian. Even now, it stays with us. When we mean to uncover the truth, we dig, say, unearth. Emblematic in paint, a signifier of the body's lacuna, the black leg is at once a grafted narrative, a redacted line of text, and in this scene, a dark stocking pulled above the knee. Here, the patient is sleeping, his head at rest in his hand. Beatific, he looks as if he'll wake from a dream. On the floor, beside the bed, a dead Moor. Hands crossed at the groin, the swapped limb white and rotting, fused in place. And in the corner, a question, poised as if to speak the syntax of sloughing a snake's curved form. It emerges from the mouth of a boy like a tongue, slippery and rooted in the body as knowledge. For centuries, this is how the myth repeats the miracle in words or wood or paint is a record of thought. See how the story changes. In one painting, the Ethiop is merely a body, featureless in a coffin, so black he has no face. In another, the patient at the top of the frame seems to writhe in pain, the black leg grafted to his thigh. Below him, a mirror of suffering, the blackamoor, his body a fragment, arched across the doctor's lap, as if dying from his wound. If not imminence, the soul's bright anchor, blood passed from one to the other, what knowledge haunts each body, what history, what phantom ache? One man always low in a grave or on the ground, the other up high, closer to heaven. One man always diseased, the other a body in service. Plundered. Both men are alive in Violdo's carving. In twinned relief, they hold the same posture, the same pained face, each man reaching to touch his left leg. The black man on the floor holds his stump. Above him, the doctor restrains the patient's arm as if to prevent him touching the dark amendment of flesh. How not to see it? The men bound one to the other, symbiotic, one man rendered expendable, the other worthy of this sacrifice. In version after version, even when the Ethiopian isn't there, the leg is a stand-in, a black modifier against the white body, a piece cut off, as in the origin of the word comma, caesura in a story that's still being written. I'm going to finish up with just a couple more poems now. This one is another Costa painting poem done by an anonymous painter toward the end of the century. The title is Torna Atras, and Torna Atras means from albino and Spaniard, a return backwards is born. Albino in this case is a very white-skinned figure who would have had what they considered to be the taint of black blood, and so would create a Torna Atras. The unknown artist has rendered the father a painter, and so we see him at his work, painting a portrait of his wife, their dark child watching nearby, a servant grinding colors in the corner. The woman poses just beyond his canvas and cannot see her likeness, her less than mirror image, coming to life beneath his hand. He has rendered her homely, so unlike the woman we see in this scene, dressed in late century fashion, a chicador, mark of beauty in the shape of a crescent moon affixed to her temple. If I say his painting is unfinished, that he is yet to make her beautiful, to match the elegant sweep of her hair, the graceful tilt of her head, has yet to adorn her dress with lace and trim. It is only one way to see it. You might see, instead, that the artist, perhaps to show his own skill, has made the father a dilettante, incapable of capturing his wife's beauty, or that he cannot see it, his mind's eye reducing her to what he's made, as if to reveal the illusion imminent in her flesh. If you consider the century's mythology of the body, that a dark spot marked the genitals of anyone with African blood, you might see how the black moon on her white face recalls it, the Rosita she passes to her child, marking him Torna Atras. If I tell you such terms were born in the Enlightenment's hallowed rooms, that the wages of empire is myopia, you might see the father's vision as desire embodied in paint. This rendering of his wife, born of need to see himself as architect of truth, benevolent patriarch, father of uplift, ordering his domain. And you might see why, to understand my father, I look again and again at this painting, how it is that a man could love and so diminish what he loves. And two more. So there's been a lot of parsing in this book. Sometimes it's language, sometimes, of course, as with an autopsy or another examination, quite literal. It was perhaps Thomas Jefferson in his Notes on the State of Virginia who first called for a kind of comparative anatomy. He believed that if doctors were to cut the Negro open, they would be able to find the root of what Jefferson believed to be innate inferiority. There were doctors that did this kind of work. This is Dr. Samuel Adolphus Cartwright on Dissecting the White Negro, 1851. To strip from the flesh the specious skin, to weigh in the brain pan seeds of white pepper, to find in the body its own diminishment, blood deep and definite, to measure the heft of lack, to make of the work of faith the work of science, evidence the word of God, Canaan be the servant of servants, thus to know the truth of this derelict corpus, a dark compendium, this atavistic assemblage, flatter feet, bowed legs, a shorter neck, so deep the tincture. See it? We still know white from not. This last poem is the last poem I wrote for the book, and I knew that I had to take my father back to Monticello in order to write it. My father took me to Jefferson's home for the first time over 25 years ago, and a lot of things have changed at Monticello in those years. If you haven't been back in a while, it is now the official position of the Jefferson Foundation that Thomas Jefferson fathered several of Sally Hemings' children, and the docent will tell you this now when you take the tour. But now that that's part of the official narrative, the other kinds of conversations you might overhear at Monticello have changed. For example, my father and I heard people talking about, as if it mattered, how much white blood Sally Hemings had. Enlightenment. In the portrait of Jefferson that hangs at Monticello, he is rendered two-toned, his forehead white with illumination, a lit bulb, the rest of his face in shadow, darkened as if the artist meant to contrast his bright knowledge, its dark subtext. By 1805, when Jefferson sat for the portrait, he was already linked to an affair with his slave. Against a backdrop blue and ethereal, a wash of paint that seems to hold him in relief, Jefferson gazes out across the centuries, his lips fixed as if he's just uttered some final word. The first time I saw the painting, I listened as my father explained the contradictions, how Jefferson hated slavery, though out of necessity, my father said, had to own slaves, that his moral philosophy meant he could not have fathered those children, would have been impossible, my father said. For years, we debated the distance between word and deed. I'd follow my father from book to book, gathering citations, listen as he named, like a field guide to Virginia, each flower and tree and bird, as if to prove a man's pursuit of knowledge is greater than his shortcomings, the limits of his vision. I did not know then the subtext of our story, that my father could imagine Jefferson's words made flesh in my flesh, the improvement of the blacks in body and mind in the first instance of their mixture with the whites, or that my father could believe he'd made me better. When I think of this now, I see how the past holds us captive, its beautiful ruin etched on the mind's eye. My young father, a rough outline of the old man he's become, needing to show me the better measure of his heart, an equation writ large at Monticello. That was years ago. Now we take in how much has changed. Talk of Sally Hemings, someone asking, how white was she? Parsing the fractions as if to name what made her worthy of Jefferson's attentions, a near-white quadroon mistress, not a plain black slave. Imagine stepping back into the past, our guide tells us then, and I can't resist whispering to my father, this is where we split up. I'll head around to the back. When he laughs, I know he's grateful I've made a joke of it, this history that links us, white father, black daughter, even as it renders us other to each other. Thank you. Thank you. So I guess I'm going to stay up here for a few questions if any of you have some questions you'd like to ask.
Well, people are getting out to the microphones. May I just ask you a question?
Sure.
A lot of the poems that you've read this evening, especially from Thrall, rely upon a visual image that you've been looking at. Mm-hmm. and in some ways are the very heart of the poem. I believe there's a sort of a term for this, ekphrasis or something
like
that.
Mm-hmm.
But I understand why you're doing that to some degree, in that the racial legacy is to be found mm-hmm. in these images. But as a poet, do you need that in order to trigger the poem in some way? Or is that just simply accidental?
Oh, you know, I like an image that triggers things, but I find that there is a kind of authority in history, in the images that we are given from the past. I could just tell you these things. I could just say to you, oh, they really thought of some people up here and some people down there, but instead, I just want to show you that painting and let you see it for yourself. So a painting does that kind of work. It provides a given image that allows me to consider what it was that the image would have said to the people in the particular historical moment who were looking at it, and what it says to us now as we confront these images. It's a way of making an argument.
Well, that question partially answered mine. Thank you, first of all, for coming. I very
thank
much
you.
Enjoyed your presentation. My question was about translation. I mean, I noticed that you read his poems today about early modern Mexico, about medieval Europe, and about the U.S. and the U.S. South.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, for you, how much of it, when you're reaching for materials, how much do you feel like you have to translate your own perspective to understand that, or how much do you think that it's just part of a palette, and you're recombining that palette without necessarily having to either translate yourself to it or it to you?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. Thank you. I definitely think there's a translation that's happening. One thing I want to say to add to that, my former question that will lead into this also, is that when I'm writing, I'm a very visual as a writer, and so. Even when I'm writing about something that I don't have a photograph of or I don't have a painting of, I make it so in my head. I look at it as if it were a painting or a photograph. So I create that image in the way that a photograph or a painting is made. The translation is indeed, I think, one of, for me, the most interesting thing that happens in a poem. I'm often drawn to an image without knowing why I'm drawn to it. It's only in the writing of the poem that I begin to see what it is I feel about what it is I've been looking at. You know, the poet Mark Doty has said that our metaphors go on ahead of us. He talks about, you know, being struck by an image in this particular essay, a display of mackerel on ice in a grocery store, and being so compelled by it, but not knowing why. So what he does is begin to describe in as much sort of concrete detail as possible what he could see. And he does that for several lines before he allows himself to make figurative comparisons, a kind of translation, before he allows the figurative to enter. And it's the concrete image of what he's seen plus the figurative language that he uses to describe it at some point that leads to a kind of insight. So the Costa paintings, I was obviously drawn to them because immediately I can see an image of my own family in some ways, you know, mother and father and child, mixed race child. But there's always something more. It's not simply that. It's something else that the painting is telling me that becomes that translation and grafting of my own feelings about not only the representation, but what it's saying to me about the interior landscape of the psyche. So not until I started describing, for example, the painting in which the mother is standing at the stove and the mixed race or mulatto child is carrying a little tray, and the father is there, you know, not really paying attention to either of them, rolling a cigarette, but with his cloak on. It wasn't until I began to make the figurative things did it suggest to me something about the absence of the father or the distance of the father. And I realized that I was sort of writing about my own father, but I was looking at something from centuries ago.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how formalism or new formalism or form in general sort of directly informs your subject matter or your poetic goals.
Mm-hmm. You know, I write in both traditional forms as well as, you know, sort of nonce forms that, you know, I've created and a kind of measured free verse, which is always also form. I found that I wrote a lot more in form for my third collection, Native Guard, and that was obviously an important way where form and content, you know, are supposed to be seamless. I was dealing with historical memory and historical erasure, and particularly, you know, about black soldiers who served in the Civil War off the coast of my hometown, who had been in many ways written out of some of the narratives on the island, written out of the historical landmarks, written out of the naming of roads and bridges and various other monuments. And so it seemed important to me that a formal tool that I might use would be, because it was necessary to re-inscribe or inscribe for the first time these things that had been erased, that I had to say a thing and say it again. And so forms that required repetition became very important to me. So, you know, a huzzle, for example, with its refrain, villanelles, pantoums, a crown of sonnets in which, you know, the last line of one sonnet becomes the first line of the next. So it became a blues sonnet also. That became the guiding sort of formal element. The poem I read, Myth, is from that book, and it's a palindrome. So it has a pattern of repetition that goes backwards, as if to enact Orpheus's descent into the underworld to find Eurydice, to get Eurydice, and his attempt to ascend back out into the world of the living, taking her with him. So form, you know, very much informed all of those. And when I started working on Thrall, I heard a different kind of music, something more syncopated than the language of Native Guard. And I had to actually break form. You know, at some point, I got so used to thinking in sonnets. You know, I got to thinking in that many lines. I got to thinking in a volta. I got to thinking in 10 syllables. And it was hard to wrench myself free of that, which I tried to do in Thrall.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm a little embarrassed to ask this question after you've gotten two such excellent ones, but it's what I like to ask every writer that I get a chance to talk to. What have you been reading lately that you've loved?
Well, do you know I just started doing a column for the New York Times Magazine?
I did not know that.
So I've basically been reading every book of poems that's out there. Every book of you know, newly released and forthcoming collections of poems that are out there, and I'm finding lots of them that I like. You know, it's a kind of reading. It's work. It's not the same kind of reading. Before that, I would have said I've been reading a lot of nonfiction. You know, a lot of memoirs, and I still am. But now that I have this job, I find myself swamped with having to read, you know, books. Boxes of books are arriving at my door every day. I have a line limit, so I've got to go through the books quickly and find the short poems and read those, and then I've got to write an introduction. And I'm looking for the things that just stand out to me that I think will translate well to a learned American audience who read poetry and those who don't. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the columns only appeared twice now. The new reissue of the New York Times Magazine happened on Sunday, February 22nd. And the first poem was a poem by a friend of mine, my late friend Jake Adam York, whose posthumous collection, Abide, is now a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award. It's a very beautiful poem. And I was thinking, as I say in the intro, of all of the poets and various other people we've lost recently. And so it has a kind of elegiac quality. The second one was an Ellen Bass poem, Moth Orchids, And it just was a knockout poem when I read it. But I liked several of her, so you know, choosing just which one I was going to get to use was tough. This week, a poem by Erica Meitner from her new book is coming out about this abandoned Packard plant. And you know, my heart just goes out to Detroit. So you know, there was no way. I mean, I know Erica had been working on that kind of stuff, and I read that poem, and I actually begged for a few more lines so that I could have a poem that was a little longer in the magazine.
Thank you.
Thanks.
As a specialist in Russian literature, I was very much intrigued by what you said about how you acquired your first name.
Yeah.
Your father was reading War and Peace.
That's right.
And when War and Peace was written, and even today in Russian literature, the difference between prose and poetry is vast, mm-hmm. because the overwhelming majority of Russian poems, even in 2015, are written in these traditional forms. Mm-hmm. So my question is this, why do you think that there's such a, so little American or English language poetry, let's say, written in traditional forms? I mean, I have made a very unkind statement about some of the so-called poetry that I've read here, that it's weak prose.
Hmm.
Now, whether the poems that you read tonight are not only phenomenal as poems, I think, but your reading style is just exquisite. I mean, even if you didn't have so much alliteration and so on, it would still very much be poetry.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, why in Russia still has a very strong poetic tradition, but the overwhelming majority of the poems are still in iambic pentameter mm-hmm. or something of that sort. And in the United States, it's quite the opposite.
Well, you know, I will say there are a lot of poets out there that are still working a lot, some even primarily in traditional forms. But I think this, I've heard this, and so I want to believe that it must be part of the case. People who talk about, I haven't done any translations, but you know, if someone has done a Dante translation, for example, you know, one of the complaints that people make is that there's so many more rhymes, you know, sonically in other languages than we have in English, and so it's often hard to do those translations. I wonder if that is indeed, you know, one issue for contemporary American poets. I also think that, you know, because of the break with tradition. I mean, when we get, you know, Walt Whitman sort of exploding things, Emily Dickinson, and then modernism. You know, this attempt to, even in the idea of Wordsworth, to speak in the kind of language of common man, that, you know, the ordinary citizen in some ways, that the poetry has gone in that direction. And so we do have to rely on other textures of sound that create a kind of formalism in what seems to be free verse poems. And I'm glad you made the point about, you know, if you hear alliteration or something. But I think also the cadences of sentences. I mean, sometimes, you know, I like to think that a poem, of all the things that it's made of, one of the things it's made of for me is sentences. I like elegant syntax. I like elegant syntax in poems in the same way that I like elegant syntax in novels. And there are some writers writing today, Toni Morrison is one of them, who writes some of the most lyrical prose, you know, I've ever heard. It sounds, I mean, so I can't say, oh, it's just, you know, prose, because it's prose that sounds like poetry. But I'll confess to you that, and this is a real confession, sometimes I will read the poems of poets who I've been told again and again have stunning musicality, and I'm just tone deaf to it. I can't hear it. But then I've heard people say about my poems that they're just prose broken up into lines. And I think, well, maybe we're just deaf to some musics, you know? I hear it in some, but not in others that I'm told are very musical. Go figure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You know, the poem I read, Myth, that palindrome, was translated into Cyrillic. I'd really like you to read it to me if you could. I'd like to know what it sounds like in Cyrillic. Oh, yes.
Many of your poems have historic or mythological allusions or references. Mm-hmm. How do you go about creating those kind of poems? Do you have an outline that you would follow? Because as a writer, it's very hard to stick with your original guidelines or outline when you're writing poetry.
Right.
So how do you go about
that? I don't think I have an outline, though I do think a poem, you know, like math, becomes an elegant equation. And that, you know, I remember being in a deductive logic class as an undergraduate and being struck at the moment that, and I'm not very good at sort of math and stuff, and the professor would be going, you know, through a problem on the board, and then he would stop and he'd say, oh, but you could also get to the end this way. And halfway through, he'd show us another way to get there. Now, I think about that when I come to a poem as an equation in some ways, because sometimes I have a sense of internal logic that I'm trying to follow to work through the poem, not simply because I know where it's going to take me. Generally, I don't know where it's going to take me, and it's better if I don't know, because, you know, it becomes a discovery. But there is something that begins to reveal itself as a poem's internal logic. And I think, you know, I'm best when I trust, you know, as Mark Doty said, that our metaphors go on ahead of us, that our poems know more than we do. And it's our job to follow them rather than trying to stick to an outline and shape them into something that they may not want to be, that we feel so destined to say. I never get so tied to something I have to say that I won't allow myself to see what else I might say if I follow what seems to be an unfolding internal logic of a poem.
Thank you.
I know that you made a choice of poems to read to us this evening, but I could not help but notice the sort of characterization of your father that you gave in a number of the poems. You've also said in your many interviews that your mother, of course, is often the inspiration behind those poems. So in poems perhaps that you didn't read, do you have the kind of characterization that's not comparable, but at least parallel to these active dialogues you were having with your father in some of the poems that you read today? Or do you see that coming more in the future? So maybe this is a question about what's happening in the future.
Well, it seems to me, I think you're right. I mean, there's one poem I didn't read in Thrall, called Calling, which is about sort of this particular image I have of my mother from my childhood that I think helped called me to be a poet. And then there's a poem in Native Guard called My Mother Dreams Another Country, in which I imagine her as a young woman pregnant with me in Mississippi, contemplating what world she's bringing a mixed-race child into. But I think it's the fact that, you know, I lost my mother when I was 19, and so that's been 30 years ago now. So many of the poems about her are elegy, and they're also an attempt to capture some moment that seems fleeting, some little thing that I might remember, like her telling me about taking me around and people thinking she was the maid. I mean, it's all sort of so distant. What I had with my father, you know, because my mother was gone, I was 19, but I continued to have my father right up until September. So all the years of me becoming a poet, all the years of me becoming an adult and making sense of the world and my place in it have happened with him right there. She wasn't there for that. And yet, I think that all the years before and everything after still are about her. For me, it's That was a hinge in my life. There was the before my mother died and after, and everything changed. And who I was before and who I could become after in the wake of her death and the legacy she left me is a thing that I'm still grappling with now. And it may not come out in poems, but I hope that's what the memoir does that I'm working on.
That's exactly what I was going to say, that I think that the search for memory is going to be the real challenge in mm-hmm. the book that you're working on, because mm-hmm. that, if we take Marianne Hirsch's notion of post-memory yeah. and all the other ideas of different levels of memory, that's a very different kind of feeling, experience, emotion. So, mm-hmm. but I'm looking forward to that book.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I just wonder if I could just do a last question. In 2013, in your second term as Poet Laureate, I believe you traveled around various cities and towns in America trying to see where poetry lives in American communities, I think was the phrase. What did you find? Where does poetry live?
Oh, gosh, America? I think poetry lives everywhere, actually. I mean, that's what's really wonderful about it, how, you know, every few years we hear some writer in a newspaper or magazine saying that poetry is dead, it's over. Nobody in America cares about poetry. They don't read it, they don't write it. But everywhere I went, and in particular in my first term, when I held office hours in the library, I had so many people coming to talk to me from all walks of life for whom poetry was meaningful, for whom poetry still mattered a great deal in their lives. And I remember one particular day, we would schedule, if it was a school group or another kind of writing group or something, I would see groups. But if there were individuals who were coming, in order to fit people in, we created these groupings of 8 to 10 people that I would sit down with and talk to. So these were strangers, you know, who were meeting for the first time in my office because they're interested in having a conversation about poetry. And on one of these particular days, there was a man who talked about going back to his 30-year high school reunion, and he had been someone who wrote poetry back then and still continues to write it. I think he might have even been a lobbyist, but he writes poetry. And so he was standing at the punch bowl with a woman who had been one of the really popular women in school, you know, a girl that might never have given him the time of day. And here they are 30 years later, and what they find is they both write poetry, and they both have been doing it, and they've been doing it in secret and not telling their family members or their coworkers, but doing it nonetheless. Everybody's doing it. Thank you.